Assalamu
alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.
Professor, welcome to our platform, SomaliStudies.com, Somali-Studies.com, where we interview and discuss ideas and specialities of Somali scholars in their knowledge and ask us to enlighten on certain issues and represent it to the youth vis-a-vis the foreigners, the Somali Supreme Court in the West.
Right.
Question number one I have, since you're a scholar of comparative literature and a poet yourself in your own right and historian, first question is, what is literature according to the Somali?
The word, as you know, Muhammad, this is really a very important question. The word literature for us Somalis is Suugaan. And what I have, it was really, in a way, by accident to a certain extent. All throughout those years, starting from Gush, going beyond Gush, going beyond Somalis who were talking about this, it was really, for me, I wanted to understand the etymology of, or the origin of that word. Suugaan in Somali, we call Suugaan the sap, that sap that is gotten from a certain plant in Somali, call it geseriot. And the sap, the plant itself is evergreen, in the sense that, you know, we come from, supposedly, not all over Somalia, but there are parts that we're talking about the inclement sort of environment. And drought is or lack of rain is what sort of troubles us most of the times. So what happens is the geseriot, the plant, is evergreen. And when all else is dead or dies, for example, it's only the sap from that plant that sustains life. And for the Somalis then, sap that sustains, nourishes physically their bodies when all else is gone is what they call Suugaan literature. And I think if we're talking about English, for example, literature, or even adab for that matter, or even literatura, if you say it, whatever else we say, in our case, it's a word that literally stands for nourishing the mind and the body. Suugaan.
Excellent. This ties perfectly well with my second question. So how much is the average Somali, and we're talking about here the average Somali,
the educated. Right.
So we're talking about the average Somali.
Right.
How much is an average Somali intellectually nourished in terms of literature?
Now, you mean average in the sense of people back home and in the diaspora to a certain, but mainly people back home, for example. Right. The majority of the Somalis. But I think what has happened, remember, Somali was only, the language, the orthography, was written in 1972. And from 1972 to 1990 is a short period. And when you think about this, it's really sad because in the presence of a state, a powerful state, the literature, the literacy rate, this all went up, as you know. At one point, we were talking about 45%, 50% at one point. Now, what has happened to the Somalis since, in terms of the collapse of the state, the destruction of the culture, the destruction of that Somaliness that we were talking about today. I think what has happened in a way is the cultural literacy of the people was affected. Now, thanks to the work that we are doing, and thanks to the work that Somali websites, for example, are doing. And here, mainly, I'm really interested in cultural websites. I'm not really interested in those that sort of talk about politics and Her Hebel y Her Hebel. That I'm not interested. But I'm interested in those cultural websites that are really contributing to the raising of the consciousness of the Somali, the ordinary Somali, the average Somali. But as you know also, there is an academy now, which is run by Muhammad Dahir Afrah. For the whole of the home, I can't remember the exact name, Academia Goboletka of Somalia. And I think what that will do in a way is it's not only about Somalia, but also about wherever Somalis inhabit. Now, to come back to the cultural literacy of our people today, it's really sad if you think about it, because you know people are on that survival mode most of the times, really. Here we could be talking about culture, we could be talking about history, but imagine in places in Somalia, but not all of Somalia, but in places where the person is either dodging a bullet or having other problems. All these sort of problems that we now associate with certain parts of Somalia. And I think in that sense, there is a lot to be done. We really have to go, we have to and to hope for. As we say, Rahmada Ebe, lagama qosto moqta. And hopefully someday. But in the meantime, I think what you are doing, what other Somalis are doing, what the academy that we're talking about is doing, what even the person who's really trying to survive in so many places in Somalia, what they are doing, I think there is that sort of hope, in the sense that there's this Gramscian kind of dictum that says, pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. Mm-hmm. That when your intellect is really, it tells you, you cannot survive. But the will says, you have to go. You have to really move on. Otherwise, the only other alternative is 6 feet deep, you are gone. Mm-hmm. So pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. And I'm really hopeful.
You kind of answered my third question about God, in terms of what the future looks like.
The future, right.
I want to interject a follow-up question, right, since you've partially answered my question, right, my final question. The follow-up question is or right, can we say a form of literature is, what you mentioned earlier,
right,
Suugaan,
right,
wisdom,
right, precisely, hikmat,
right, problem solving,
right,
passing on,
right,
narratives,
right,
stories,
right,
folklores, and those sort of things that,
right,
have their end.
Right.
And can we say, in that sense, the around the fire camp stories that the people used to have, in whether they were Romans,
right,
or not, cultures have.
Yeah.
And these things that have been passed on and,
right,
have been improved on,
right,
that it is a form of literature,
right,
following on the innovative mind that was Ibn Khaldun.
Absolutely.
And how he defined the evolution of societies,
right,
and cultures,
right,
by passing on narrative,
right,
improving on it, and always challenging the,
right,
stereotypical mindset that
it's only written, exactly. In fact, I talk about this in Daybreak. There is this assumption that when we talk about literature, we are talking about written literature, that people who are quote-unquote, and there aren't people, I haven't come across any people in this world who are really illiterate in the true sense of the word, at least even in Somalia, and in other places where you find Muslims, there is the Quran. And the first edict of the Quran is Iqra. Iqra, exactly, recite, literally. But I think what has happened when I talk about written and oral, for example, I use the image of back home, you guys are kids. Back home, I remember girls of my age sort of really playing what was called a cat, in this case, cat's cradle. And cat's cradle is when they have a band and they make configurations. they have a band or a piece of, exactly, that's called cat's cradle. So they play with this. And I always tell the students in America that the configurations that you make come from your mind. That the band itself is only a medium. In much the same way, therefore, that written, when you write, or when you tell it orally, these are only mediums. Hikmat, wisdom, and all the good things that you're talking about actually come from the human mind. It's only the way we exactly.
Thank you very much. Any advice that you want to share with the youngsters earlier as the conclusion was in terms of how to improve literature and what they can do themselves to bring the next generation up there?
I think the most important thing really is for the next generation, for us, is first to do what you are doing. It's this is the most important thing. Exactly, no one else is telling you do this, but you literally do it on your own, which literally means that you believe in the importance of the project. And once you believe in the importance of the project, I think you understand it, one, its importance to you. You understand it, its importance to your people, the Somalis, in that sense. You understand it, its importance to history, and that you are really on the cusp of making some good things, that you are really making history. But above all, I think it's important to also really talk to the older generation, and transcribe things, tape them, talk to them, question them, because challenge them, because it's really sad. For each old person who dies in Africa, and especially in our case, where we are talking about illiterate society, for example, it's a whole library. Really, that's
a money goal, I think.
And exactly. I wish I'll give you an example now. There were people that I knew back in Somalia who really knew something about literature. And I'll give you examples. I went to from Hudur to all the way to Gandala and in between. And what I found, for example, was there was this fellow, an old fellow, Sheikh Abdullahi in Baidawa, in that area. Sheikh Abdullahi Fiqo Muhammad Dahir. There's this guy, his son, who passed away also. I'm talking about older people here, who was a general manager, I think, at one point. And he was a professor of economics, Muhammad Dahir Haji Abdullahi Fiqo. I met with his father when we were writing the biography of the president, rahimahullah, where we went to Baidawa, we went to all of them. And what he was really talking about was really amazing. And he's gone now. We went to Bosaso. And I remember I met a lot of older people who really knew what they were talking about. There was this fellow in Ishak Abdwak Akhtar Tulahed. Yeah, Balamu. I met, and by now I think he's gone also, because he's an old man. Diriainte, he was very old. This is really true. This is a long, long time. And then you had people in Mogadishu, I remember, of Robin Hassan, who really, and he's gone. You talk about people in riverine areas, they are all gone. But Muhammad Hadi Mukhtar, that you know, his father was 107 when he passed away, 108. And he had the Hudur, the, what do you call that, that whole area, their history, their literature, their whatnot. And I sort of, Sharif Saleh.
Sharif Saleh?
Sharif Saleh.
It's
out.
Oh, it's been out for one volume. He has 600 pages book on
Hadr. Is it available on
he gave it to me when he was alive.
Alive, right. Is it available?
I'll try to get you a copy, inshallah.
Okay, mashallah, thank you. Sharif Saleh. Mm-hmm. And you sort of talk about, you look at these people and the sort of knowledge that they have.
In essence, what you say is,
right.
Since we lack a form of archives, since we lack concrete inherited knowledge and documented knowledge,
right.
That this current generation that has access to that still, in one way or
exactly. With these technologies.
With these technologies specifically right. at hand.
Exactly.
And everything becomes digitized now.
Exactly.
Digitized and right. everything and archival
right.
stuff.
Right.
That we should accumulate what we can and archive it and organize it.
Exactly.
And let the following generation assess.
Assess, build on it.
Theorize.
Theorize whatever they want to do. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.